Again, welcome all you visionaries, as Ivan was saying. We were discussing last night with Jefferson and Julia that among all the trends surrounding the game universe, probably voice-driven games are probably on top. The fast penetration of voice assistants, the rising popularity of podcasts,
right,
or the steady sales growth of audiobooks are strong signals of how technologies and audiences are ready to experience audio and its immersive power, no? From telling stories, but also to play games. No? We have Jefferson, which is CEO and co-founder of Doppio Games, a voice first game studio based in Lisbon. He was also the lead designer of the studio's debut title, The Vortex, and he has an extensive career on mobile games. And he switched to this new adventure.
Yeah.
And we have also Julia Newman. She's a writer and narrative designer. She started her career in film, TV, and theater, and she moved into games. The last one that, correct me if I'm wrong, but the last one that, or the most recent, is the fully audio-based Alt Frequencies. Next to this, she also develops, writes, and directs immersive theater productions and projects that combine live locations and gameplay elements. No? And together with them, I think we would like to, I'm not share with you this panel and see, explore a little bit more like the possibilities of voice-driven or audio-based games. And I will start with Jefferson, asking you, all your life dedicated to games and especially mobile games, no?
Yep.
in world-renowned studios. So what has taken you to focus on voice-first games?
Yeah, I think it's a mix of like creative motivation, but also business motivation. So I think like when I, like you mentioned, like I've been making mobile games for a long time. I started in 2005 when like the mobile games were really bad, actually. Like they're all like really, you know, Java and Brew and like this, the user experience wasn't that great, but you know, a lot of people played them back in the day. And I think that kind of informs my experience with voice now as well. Mobile is a really good market if you have like a success. It can be a huge success, right? So the companies that are big are really big, like Supercell and King, et cetera. But I think for a small company, it's hard to go and compete with these people who have massive budgets and huge teams and IP and all those other things, right? So as I was thinking about starting a company, voice excited me for those two reasons. First, because, I mean, who knows how to make games with your voice? Nobody does, so it's actually really exciting. There's no games to copy. It's not like I can just go to the store and play two games and mix them up and then I'm successful. It's not like that. Like, nobody knows what they're doing. So there's like a creative part of it, which is super exciting. And the second part is, I really believe, you know, we're talking about the trends of podcast, and I don't know if you guys follow the internet trends document. There's, I forgot the name of the lady who puts together, like every year she puts like these internet trends. She used to work at Kleiner Perkins and now she's at Bond. And this year she had some slide about the growth of podcasts, which like super crazy, mm-hmm. and smart speakers. So these are all big trends in content consumption. Like audio used to be maybe not as popular, but you know, it's actually like pretty good to do when you're doing something else. So there's like a lot of, it enables you to do consume stuff like when you're driving or when you're going to work or different things. So it's helps to fill the day, right? Like with, so you're always watching something. It doesn't matter what time of the day. So I think that business aspect of it, which is like, you know, there's a growth of devices, a growth of usage. There's the tech part, which, you know, voice used to be like bad tech, but you know, the tech is getting better and better all the time. Plus the fact that like nobody knows what they're doing is super exciting to me. And I think as a small company, it's a good opportunity because you go in, and the big companies are not paying attention because it's not enough money for them. So they're focusing on mobile and console. And you know, in the meantime, I can kind of try to carve my way, and then hopefully, you know, a couple of years, 3 years from now, then I can be one of the big ones, or I can get bought by them. I don't know. We'll see what happens. But as long as I don't crash and burn, I think it's. I mean, even if I do, it's still fun. It's the most creatively interesting thing I've done in the last 10 years. It's super, super exciting area.
Uh-huh. And Julia, and in your case, you've written for TV, film, also theater plays, immersive theater plays. Now you've made this Alt Frequencies voice-based mobile game. What would you say is the why have you chosen audio for this game? And what do you think is the power of audio, no, for games?
Well, to start with, I think I when I moved from film and TV and theater more into games, because I was interested in the interactive aspect, one of the things that I had to get used to is not using actors, because I wrote a lot for mobile games and there's usually not a lot of voice acting in that. Mm-hmm. So that was one of the things that I always missed, because I was really spoiled that I had a career in working with actors, and being used to them reading my lines aloud. So that was quite a big difference, and that also made me think more about something that was like normal to me, mm-hmm. but obviously wasn't normal in games. And personally, I'm really interested in like the individual gaming experiences that people can have, and that's also what I do in immersive theater. I'm trying to give people really individual personal experiences, and there's nothing more personal than somebody talking to you, mm-hmm. Just being addressed one-on-one by somebody who speaks to you and asks you something or tells you something. So in Alt Frequencies, I was able to get back to that aspect in both working with actors, but also making use of that aspect of what happens when there's just a voice talking to you. What is the impact of that way of storytelling? And I was really lucky that Accidental Queens, the studio that made this game, asked me to write this for them, because I could use those experiences in trying to get that vision across.
Mm-hmm. It's funny you mentioned like the voice, like the power of like somebody talking to you. I remember I was at PAX one year. I don't know, like, you know, I was a BioWare at the time, and then I played a lot of Mass Effect, and my romance was with Liara, like when. The Blue Lady, and then at this event, like, we were there, like, representing BioWare and stuff, and the actress who did the voice, she was like with me on the stage, right? And then I thought, like, oh, you know, my Liara is my romance, and then she was like teasing me during the conference. But yeah, there's a time I think I was like sitting, we're talking about stuff, and then she just came behind me and said, "Shepherd," and I'm like, because it makes you like, kind of sweat a little bit. It's like, oh my God, she's here. Yeah, it's amazing like how like something so kind of simple, you think, like gets like such a big emotional response. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's also, I think it's also the there's even more imagination going on there by just hearing that voice. Like it when she did that to you, it brought you back to into that game probably.
Did, yeah.
And sort of it gives you a reaction that you usually don't really think about. But
mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, obviously, I think audio has this immersion power, no? That to immerse you in the story, to steer your imagination, sometimes when you hear about voice-driven games, no, it's since we're used to play games that have an interface, which probably is more of a screen or a board. No? Talking about that, it's hard sometimes to imagine how's the gameplay.
Right.
Of a game, and I would like to ask you, how do you approach, you know, like the gameplay of a voice driven game?
Yeah, in my case, like I mean, this is a big question that we faced in the beginning, because we decided to like focus on, I mean, some of the Alexas have screens and you could focus on a game that you can see stuff, but like because most of them don't, so we decided to make a game where you didn't need a screen. Honestly, the first week or two, I was just like, what am I going to do? I have no idea. Like, I never made a game that didn't have a screen or like a HUD or a score or some graphics, or like, how do I tell people what's going on? How do I remind people what they're trying to do? Like, all those things are like big questions. And you know, I think every journey starts with a step. So we decided, like, played with a little bit, and then we made some prototypes, and then we tested with people. Some stuff people like, some stuff they don't. So we kind of kept improving, and you know, eventually we shipped the game. But yeah, it's a... you got to approach it from a different way. Like, you got to understand like the limits of, you know, human memory and like all sorts of things. Like, it's super important to test with people because, again, like, it's not like there's a, actually there are books about it. I was just going to say there's no books about it, but there are. They're mostly from support, like call support, because like that's the only area that studied voice seriously. And it's like when you call people and there's like some voice thing, like all the books about it are actually from those guys. It's really funny. So I read those books too, but you know, they don't help you make a game, but they do teach you about, you know, the limits of voice and how people react, like, you know, the gender, based on the gender that the person is talking to you, like humans react differently, like, you know, like people relate more to the same gender, and there's certain types of information that people get, they give more trust if it's this type of person, this type of voice, or this type of tone, or this type of speed. So all those things matter. But honestly, you still gotta, even if you read all this stuff, you still gotta test because nobody knows like how to put that together in a game. It's a kind of interesting journey.
Julia?
Yeah, it's interesting what you're saying about how the things that you encounter when you don't have a screen. We had sort of the same thing, but we do have a screen, and we came up with the same things because Old Frequencies is a game that is, it's purely audio based. You play it on mobile, you can play it on, it's for PC as well. You can play it on Steam. And but it started out as a mobile game. And one of the objectives of the studio was to make it fully accessible for blind people. Mm-hmm. And by fully accessible, they meant like there shouldn't be anything in this game that could be an advantage if you're sighted. Mm-hmm. So any visual things that we have cannot be an advantage in the gameplay or in the story or whatever. And we need the screen because the game plays with recording and sending information. So basically you need to swipe. You don't need sight to do that. and there's screen readers as well that help you with voice commands. But we have that screen, so there is stuff on that screen. We have the text that you hear. You can read it on the screen if you want, which makes sense. And we have a bit of artwork there as well, because the game is about radio stations, so you can see, like, you flick through the stations, they all have their own logos and stuff like that. But at the same time, having that screen while at the same time being a fully audio game confuses people as well, because if you have that screen, people expect you to visualize
screen,
stuff.
The
and
screen
yeah,
is so powerful. It's really, exactly. It's really interesting learning we had when we were testing the game before. During development, I used an Echo Show, which is the one that has the screen, and you know, it kind of lists the things you can do in the game. You can ask for it, but like if you have a screen, it's kind of listed there. I had people who couldn't play with the screen because the screen's so powerful that they just went and said the first thing that was on the screen. So they start doing. They're like, I'm not choosing anything. I'm just following. So they actually put the screen down and kept playing because it's so strong, like the visual aspect of it. Like, it just overwhelms like all the other senses.
Exactly. So, and people want to, like, they'll comment on the way it looks because they think that's important, or they'll think maybe something will start happening on the screen. So in that aspect, it's quite contrasting to say, well, this is fully audio, and then still have that screen. So, but on the other hand, like we were talking about yesterday, like the game that we made, because of the gestures, we couldn't have made it for an Alexa.
Right.
Not yet, at least. So we need that screen. And you don't want to have like a black screen either, because that makes no sense.
What sort of game mechanics, based on your experience, work better? Do you have any specific examples? What sort of game mechanics work well for a voice-driven game?
I mean, for voice, I think, you know, we had this conversation in my session earlier, like, you can use it for commands, but I think it's more natural if it's like conversation. So you can make a game where it's about talking to someone, it's the most natural use of it, to the point where like our game doesn't even have a tutorial. And the only reason why we can get away with this is because it's a conversation. Everybody knows how to have a conversation, you know? So like there's no need to teach people what to do. It's just a question and you answer, and then you're in the middle of the story. And then if you don't know what to do, you can say like, what can I do? And then like you get some hints. But You can use it for commands, like, you know, right, left, whatever. But I think some of the most popular games right now are like trivia and things like that. So quiz, you know, like where they ask you for specific knowledge and you answer. So that's another like popular use. I'm really looking forward to the future where right now we don't get tone or stress. Like we just get the word. Like at some point you'll be able to do like something like a whisper, and you know we can use that as input as well. Like right now that's not available. I mean, if you use your own tech or something like that, you can do it, but not on Alexa, for example. I'm really looking forward to those things because right now we have words, but you'll be able to do things like, you know, whistling and like different things. I think if you look at some console games like Alien Isolation, like did use the Kinect really well. Like, as you know, kind of if you make a noise in your house, the alien will listen to you in the game, so you got to be in your living room like, shut up, everybody. So yeah. That kind of stuff's cool. I think there's a lot of like interesting things you can do with sound, with you know, audio and voice.
Things like that help the immersion as well, I think, because if you're only able to just input a word and not have that conversational feel, it's less immersive. I see that a lot with like simple Alexa games that are really basic and still can be interesting, but you're constantly reminded of the fact that you're talking to a computer and you're not immersed. And that if you're able to make that bigger and like you say, like have a normal conversation and use inflection and stuff like that. With old frequencies, we did that by not having the player talk themselves, because basically what you have to do is you use parts of the conversations on the radio stations, which is normal conversation, and you record them and you send them to other stations. So basically you are in a conversation with them, but you don't use your own voice, you use snippets of other people. Mm-hmm. And then that feels natural to the receiver of that information, mm-hmm. and they will act natural back to you. So that still feels like an immersive moment, instead of you feeling that you're sort of butting in mechanics.
Yeah, I see that one tends to see that the most simple mechanics, like you were saying, maybe a trivia or making choices would be like mechanics that would fit easily, you know, into a game.
Yeah.
But yours, for example, is a little bit more elaborate on the Vortex. Can you explain a little bit more?
Yeah, we tried very hard to make it feel like you can say anything. That caused us no end of trouble because it's very hard when you let people say anything, they will literally say anything. They come up with like all sorts of stuff. So it was a challenge, but you know, most story games are basically like you come to a place and you say, hey, you're here. Do you want to go right or do you want to go left? So and they do it because it's easy to recognize, split those two words, and you know, it kind of can guide. And there's some choice, and it's interesting. But in our game, like basically, the robot that's helping you, it just says, what do you want to do now? Mm-hmm. And then like you say, I don't know. Like, what can I do? And they say, well, we're here. We're trying to reactivate the AI, so we should probably like repair this thing. And you say, oh, let's repair the thing. And it's like, okay, I'm going to go repair it. And that's how the game works, right? It feels a little bit more natural. That's kind of what we're going for. But again, it was a lot more work because we had to be ready for people to say many things. And you know, one of the cool things about like you know, this platform is that it allows us, we see all the words that people are trying to say that we didn't plan for. So of course, there's people like cussing the robots, like saying, you know, screw you or whatever. And they were like, of course they're going to say that. So in the beginning, the game didn't handle that. Like the robots just said, oh, I don't know what you mean. But now, after we figured it out, then we have that in the game now. So if you cuss one of our robots, it's going to say, wow, you kiss your mother with that mouth. And mm-hmm. so it kind of gets and that helps with immersion. Because like if you say something crazy and the game reacts appropriately, like it really impresses you. When we do the like playtesting, there are generally two what I call magic moments. Like one of them was when people said something that they thought for sure was not going to work, and then the game recognized it. Like you can see in their eyes, they were like, "What?" Like for instance, you know, the game asks like, "Hey, do you like this thing?" And then people would say, instead of saying yes, they would say something like, "Definitely." And then they would be worried that, like, as they were saying, they were like, oh, it's not going to work because I didn't say yes. But then, you know, we made the game so you can say yes, definitely, yep, for sure, like you, all those things work. So when they said it, the game worked, and they were like, what? It worked? So that's like one of the magic moments. And the other one is, if you ask the game for something and the game tells you, and then you ask the same thing, you get a different answer. Because if it's repetitive, like if I always say, like, what can I do now? Oh, you can go right. Okay, what can I do now? Or tell me something else, you can go right. Like it's like it breaks you out of that immersion as well. So having that variety, like, you know, a lot of the senses of the game, we have 5 versions of it, just so we do it in different ways. When you come back to the game, it's like, welcome back. Good to see you. We missed you. Like, there's like a, and also there's longer ones based on, if you've been away from the game for a long time, we say like, oh, we missed you. If you just came back, it's like, let's go. Like, it's a, we also use context like to do those things, and all those things help. Because when you realize like, oh, I've been away for a week and they miss me, it's kind of cool, you know? So I think there's a, but again, that's a lot of work, but yeah. You know.
And that, but you need that work for the audio games because you can't mask it with anything else.
Right.
That variety, like if you make a video game with awesome visuals and big gameplay and you have like, I don't know, you're playing a shooter and you have like barks that come back every now and then just because you can't write like millions of them. You will hear it and it might be a bit annoying, but because the visuals are most likely different from the previous time that you hear that same sentence, or you're just doing something that is different, it will mask a bit of that repetitiveness.
Uh-huh. Right.
But in audio, you don't have anything to mask that. So if for instance, we had the same with our game, because you can send stuff and it's radio and it's live, so you expect people not to repeat the same thing because it's live. And that live aspect is so important in our game that we can't. So you need all of those variations because people will hear it immediately because there's nothing there to mask it. So
yeah.
It's even more important to have that variety. But as you say, it's a lot of work and a lot of content.
Mm-hmm. And choosing, for example, that game mechanic is making you also to go for text-to-speech and not VO.
Yeah.
Because if you have to give no, those complex answers, it's not as easy as, okay, we're going to record
exactly.
All possibilities now. So what on based on your experience, I would like to share with the audience a little bit, but I don't know, let's see if we're able to establish the do's and the don'ts of an audio game. what would you say it's a must or the do's for an audio game? What do you have to keep in mind the whole time? One is immersion, as we were saying. You know, like
yeah, I think you know that kind of variety and the like. Try to keep it natural. It's a good part of it. I would say I really like reinforce testing. Like you know, play with like test, because like the so many times like we because you know we think we're so smart, so we design this thing and it's beautiful, and then we put it in front of people and they break it in the first sentence, and you're like ah. But it's good because you learned it and you improve. I think testing with real people helped us a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And the cool thing about audio too is because it's approachable. So we didn't test just with you know gamers or like we tested like with everyone I had nearby. It's like hey you play this, and people were like what? But I don't know. I never played an audio game. It's like mm-hmm. Here's your first. And it's actually like easy to because you just talk and So testing I think is a big one. The other one I would say, you gotta think about what kind of experience you have. I think, or you want to have. Some games, some of the kind of like Jurassic World, which is like a big production kind of Alexa game. They kind of talk for like 5 minutes, and then they ask you a question,
uh-huh.
And then it's like 5 minutes of dialogue and then a question. So that kind of like taking you in and out of the chair, like it's a little bit of it's jarring. I think like it's better if you either make something more passive or, which is fine too, and or if you're gonna be more interactive, then you should try to keep it going. Because it's hard to like, the lack of a screen also makes people like float, right? So like every time people play the game, I realize people like looking up or looking at the stairs or looking at the shoes, because like they don't have anything to look at, so it's weird.
But also, it's easy to get distracted. So I think that's you gotta drive the experience well. We can't just like leave it to chance. Like you really gotta drive it.
Julia.
Well, I think one of the first things that springs to mind for me is that if you're making an audio game, don't assume that people will understand what you're doing until it's done. Because for us, we did have actors, and not text to speech, and we have a game that has a lot of branches, but also branches that are partly random, just because you can, like you said already, you can break in at any time. You have so conveying that on paper and explaining to people who work with you or investors or funding or whatever what it is that you're exactly doing is like it's if you're not into making that game, people have no idea because they can't really. It's really hard to convey how things will pan out because you can't show it on paper. And for this game, a prototype was made first, but that also had to have actors. So that means that you have to invest a lot of time and money to make sure that you have that prototype to test whether, because I totally agree, testing is always important, but for this it's essential from the first moment because it's new, and like you said, you can never predict player behavior, but in this case you really can't predict player behavior because players, I think it's comparable with like VR in that sense that often you see that when people start playing VR, I think that it was addressed yesterday as well in the talk, that if they haven't played VR before, they will just be thinking about, oh, this is VR, I can throw stuff, and they're not working on the game. Mm-hmm. They're just being like, oh, this is cool, this is nice. Oh, that's sort of with audio games, you have a similar thing, like, oh, this is new, so people will focus on the wrong things.
Explore the space rather than follow the game.
Exactly, and that's something that you can't predict unless you've made like a thousand of those games. So yeah, testing and don't take for granted that people will get it if you don't have the audio yet to...
Yesterday when we were talking, I found interesting that both share like the same starting point, which was make a list of the limitations.
Right.
Yep.
Okay, I have these limitations, and from there on, you started to write the game. No.
Yep.
What might be the differences to write an audio-based game than writing a normal game?
Where to start?
Well, like one example is like you know, the fact that you need, like if you're doing audio, you need people to be able to listen. So you know, there's things like they need either like you know headphones or something. So I think there's a limitation right there, because if you think about mobile games, again, I worked on mobile games for a long time. We always had, in particular when I was in Finland, we had like a guy who's amazing, amazing musician. Like he would compose like amazing songs for every game we made, and nobody would listen to them because like people just mute their phones when they're playing, and that's it. So like, So on mobile, you can't count on people, like you can't put audio cues to play because you can't count on people having the sound on. I mean, you can force people and say like, hey, please put your headphones, otherwise you're not going to be able to play, and then sure. But as a natural state, people are not going to be able to, the audio's not on, right? So I think there's one thing. If you're going to make an audio game, maybe don't make a mobile game, I guess. I don't know. Like it's different devices and different like, the context, like where you want people to play, again, the same thing. Because if you're in the subway, if you have headphones, it's fine. But if not, then how can you play one of those things, right? And then at home, audio is a little bit disruptive. So for instance, like the Alexa, a lot of people I talk to are like, oh, have you played the game? It's like, no, because you know my kid. And because the Alexa is generally in a like communal place in the house. So like if you're using it, everybody is in, right? So sometimes that's fun. Sometimes you don't want to do that because like you don't want to be playing a game and then somebody else is like on the other room like, hey, I'm trying to study here or whatever, right? So I think you got to think about those things too. I think it's a like
context.
Yeah, context. Where will people play? How will they play it? That was something that's important for us as well. We had the usual limitations, but then for audio, like this, how big and how long will this be? Because especially working with actors and having to record everything, and we had amazing audio design, but a lot of it, because again, audio, you need something extra. We had radio, so you need all of those. So that's the limitations right there. Also something that was very clear from the start is thinking about, we have a lot of characters in our game. I think we have about 22 characters, mm-hmm. which is a lot. And people won't see them. They won't have any idea what they look like, which is fine, which is great, actually. But that also means that they will have to be instantly recognizable, because you need to, from the get-go, the first time you hear somebody, you will need to understand what kind of person it is, be fully immersed from the first moment into what they want to convey to you. So you don't have time to do some chit-chat. You need to be there from the start, which again, for us, making something about radio, which is chit-chat or news, makes it really hard. But also later on in casting, like how will they sound? Make sure you have different sounding actors, because people will need to hear who they are listening to. Yeah. And also, like you were saying, don't talk like for 5 minutes and then have a choice. Also, you need to sometimes repeat stuff a bit more, because people can't scroll back like, oh, what did I miss? Mm-hmm. They hear it and then it's gone. Yeah. So if you have important information, then yeah. So it's, you need a bit more detail on that to make sure that people don't miss important stuff.
Yeah, we talking about the voices. So true. Like we had there's like four robots you play with in the, well, five, but six actually, now that I keep counting them. But the main ones you talk to, like that you talk to a lot, there are four of them. And one of them is like, you know, American voice, like super full of energy. Yeah, let's go do this. Yeah, let's go. And then the second one is more British. So it's like, oh, we're all gonna die. What's the point? And and then the third one is Australian, so it's a little bit more kooky, says some random words. And so we tried to play off like the accent. So we actually got, because Alexa has different countries for the accents, and there's like a Welsh version. And like, so we played on that. So like we specifically made them different accents. And of course, those accents have a bit of a stereotype attached, so we kind of played off that, because you know, we don't want to teach people about the characters, but you know, just by playing the game for a little bit, you can kind of figure out, oh, this guy is more up for it, this guy's a bit. And then of course, like when there's like some action thing you gotta do, and then you send the British robot, he's always like, oh, why me? Like I'm not made for this, like what are you? But if you send the other guy, he's like, woo, let's go, like the more American one, right? It's like they kind of react appropriately if you send them to do the right thing that fits their personality. Again, it doesn't affect necessarily the gameplay, but it helps with the immersion, because like it makes you feel like they are more real.
Yeah. You instantly feel what sort of person they are, robot they are. Yeah.
But yeah, we specifically called. That's a great point. I forgot about that. But like we specifically got like different accents for all of them, like so they would be instantly recognizable.
Yeah, that helps so much for us. We have our game is in English, French, and German spoken language. But especially for the English one, that we had a discussion at first, like, is this like, are they American or are they British? But our game takes place in a fictitious world that looks a lot like ours, mm-hmm. but it is fictitious. So we said, well, we can go with basically mixing up all of those accents because we need them, and it will help with immersion. And thankfully, when we tested it out, people weren't like confused by it, because other than like you were explaining that they have like characteristics that work with the accents. We try to use the accents without pointing to a specific ethnicity, because basically they're all living in that same area, and it might sound different, but it's not like, oh, he's an American or he's an Englishman so that was something that we mixed up, but it worked perfectly, because you need that for the immersion.
We never really explained why our robots have like Australian. Just glossed over. Hey.
Besides yours, which are great games, if we could recommend the audience or share with the audience some, references like in audio games, what would you say is like a, I don't know, a best practice? Do you have anyone in mind?
Audio.
I played the top of my mind.
Yeah, I played. Look at my phone. Actually, there's a lot of like audio, like cool audio. A lot of them are made for like blind people. Yeah, Blind Legend, and you know, there's a bunch of like mobile games that are kind of interesting. And they are audio because you know they're targeting people who can't see. I think if you think about games that use audio in interesting ways, I mean, if you just like specifically about Alexa, you know, Jeopardy is probably the most popular. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of interesting just because of that. It's a good use of the theme and the voice, and it kind of just works. Jurassic World, I mentioned, is kind of like nice production. Like I said, I don't necessarily agree with all the design decisions, but I think it's well done. It's kind of well written, well acted, like it's all like nice voiceovers, and it kind of goes through like together with the movie, like the story kind of goes around the story of the last movie. I'm trying to remember like the cool, there's a PC game, there's a, can't remember. No, sorry. Next time.
I think actually if you're interested in making an audio game or at least making something that has more of an audio aspect in it, that it's also interesting to, because it's so new, to listen to a lot of things to see what works for you, not just game, but also like podcasts, like the production value of podcasts can be really interesting for us. At least that was a really big influence to just see like, how do they convey their story and how could you place gameplay elements in that? And the other way around, like for the Alexa, because we researched if we could do something with Alexa and played a lot of games on there that weren't particularly really good games, but they were very interesting to us because there's a lot of people who just try things out for the Alexa because it's so new.
Yeah.
And you can learn from what they did, like, oh, this works, this doesn't really work, this is interesting. There's still, because it's fairly new, there's just so much to be learned from basically everything that's out there in audio games and also in podcasts. Yeah.
Okay. I was also wondering, no, like there's some trends that they're just fads. And they just the hype of it, and their trends that they come to just to stay with us for a long time. So my question would be, why do you think audio games are here to stay? Why they're not just a fad that will disappear?
I think that audio games at least serve an artistic challenge that is really interesting. So. Just talking about creators, not about the audience. I think that there's a lot of people who are interested in it and will try to explore audio games. Mm-hmm. And like we're talking about podcasts and stuff like that, that has seen a real surge as well. People trying out stuff also really creatively. So I think and I hope that will be a bit closer together, like podcasts and gaming, that there is going to be something there in between. So I think that from an artistic point of view, there's a lot to be done there, and there's enough people who will be and get interested in that. From the audience point of view, I think it depends on which way the development will go. So for the smart speakers, a lot of people have smart speakers now. How are they using them? Will it be for them a proper console, or will they just use it for starting music? And I think that is hard to predict at the moment. Mm-hmm. So from that point of view, I hope it will be here in a couple of years. But it depends on what the audience mm-hmm. is interested in.
Yeah, in our particular case, like I think we talked about this before, like we don't necessarily consider ourselves like an audio game developer, like we consider ourselves like a voice interface mm-hmm. kind of game developer. And the reason why we believe in that is because, you know, I really think voice is here to stay. It's a matter, it's too good, like, not to work, right? It's fast in typing. It's like, you can give a lot of information very quickly. There's a lot of context that goes in your accent, like your, like it's a super good way to transmit information. So I think, you know, you can use that. There will be fun things with that. What it's going to be, speakers or TV or everything. I think it's going to be a mix. People will be using a voice for everything. I also, once I started doing this, now I realize there's a lot, like if you watch a lot of like, you know, Netflix and those shows, like there's a lot more shows now where people use voice interface. And again, this is kind of like the equivalent of like a, you know, like Minority Report in the past, but you see now there's a lot of shows where like people are just doing things with a voice and I realize it's because again, this like the TV people are getting the zeitgeist of this, and they're like, okay, this is going to be a thing, and they just start to use it. Doesn't mean it's going to stay, but I particularly think voice is just like too good. It's as an interface, as a human interface. Yeah, I mean, I guess up until we start doing neurotransmission mind thinking, I guess like at some point maybe voice is going to die. I guess, but
And I think also to add to that from a accessibility point of view, I think that in games in general, there's been more attention to that aspect, to how to make your games accessible mm-hmm. to everybody right. or to people with specific handicaps. I have enjoyed it immensely to work on a game that had this specific thing about making sure that it's equally playable for blind people. And I've learned so much from that, that I know that I will take that with me to other games as well. Uh-huh. So I think that because there's more room for that and more interest in that, that will also add to more audio games coming out, or at least more, let's say, audio aware games being released, mm-hmm. because you can see that through the game design community happening now.
Yeah. Okay, so I don't know. I think we talked a lot. Ask you all the questions that I had, but probably the audience has some other questions that they would like to ask you. So please, if you have any questions, now's the moment. Yeah. Here.
Hello. So I really like audio content. I listen to a lot of podcasts, and it's been that way for a long time. So when Siri was first introduced, I was really excited because it sounded like something big to be able to control stuff with your voice. But later on, I haven't really used it because I think that there's... I don't know if it's about confidence when talking to a machine or what, but I think that in many occasions we'll limit ourselves and try not to do it, either because we are with other people or because it feels kind of weird somehow. The technology has advanced and now the voice that talks back is really natural and all that stuff, so that helps. But in my environment, I still see people that don't really use that kind of technologies because it feels weird, so to say. So do you think that will change, or do you think that audio games will be like, now I'm going to start playing and kind of break the barrier?
I think it has to do with that the place where you're in, like you were commenting before. It's really weird to think of having that voice command be more and more important while at the same time we use text messages and WhatsApp to communicate. So actually, like, we don't call each other anymore with our phones, but we do have the possibility now to talk to, not to our friends, but talk to the phone itself, which is a weird contrast. But like you say, I think it also has to do with where you are. You might not talk to Siri with friends, but you might do it when you're alone. So I think context is really important in that matter, but you work more with that system.
It's all true. Like the context is everything. But also, I have to say, like in the late 90s or whatever, when like people started wearing Bluetooth headsets, like they were all weird. And now everybody is doing it. Like people are walking on the streets talking to themselves and it's fine. People are like conscious in the beginning of what they're doing now. They're talking about WhatsApp, but like, you know, I'm from Brazil. I don't know how you guys use WhatsApp here, but a lot of my family, when they talk to me, it's like audio. Like I don't get a text anymore. I just get this audio thing. And I'm like,
that's
oh, God damn
yeah.
it. Like, listen to the audio. But like, but again, because it's more convenient.
Yep.
They can give more information. They can convey more emotion. They can convey, it's just more expressive than text. So I think the people will be using both, I think. I think we'll get more natural. It will never be like, you know, again, it's hard to be subway and then talking to yourself. Like some people do it, but it's not, I don't think it's going to be for everyone ever, but so context is always going to be a thing, but I also think it's going to become more normal that people are going to be. The other thing too is like today you talk to one of these things and it doesn't work, it makes you feel stupid, so you don't do it again. Like it's very common that people try and then it doesn't work and then you're like, oh, stupid thing, and then you don't try again. But you know they're going to get better, both the hardware, the microphone, the quality of the microphone that's capturing. Like one of the problems with Siri is using the phone and you never speak to Siri like this, right? You're always speaking like in a weird angle, so the microphone might not be capturing the thing perfectly. But as the hardware advances and the software advances, I think it's going to be more normal. It's never going to be the same as something else because it's not a private thing, it's a public. Oh, by the way, it's another thing I really found out. I think about the power of voice is like texting something and saying it out loud feels different.
Yeah.
It feels more commitment. And you know that's why sometimes people yep. don't want to do it, they want to text. But in our game, when people say like, oh, like even if some people say in the game, you ask like, are you single? And sometimes people say yes. When they're married, and they kind of feel a little guilty. Because like, I just said yes, but I'm married. Like, what did I do? If it was a game, they would just do it, like press A and it would be
yeah.
fine. But like, because they'd said it, like there's something in the brain which is like, what do you mean? What do you mean? Like, we're married, we're married. Yeah, it's different. I mean, it's new. Who knows how it's going to end? I mean, that's why I think personally it's exciting. I think, you know, it's kind of growth, different things to try. It could all burn down in flames, that's true. But I'm hopeful.
Here we have one. Question.
Hi, so a while back I was playing the Skyrim version of Alexa and I found that it was very difficult to orient myself in the virtual invisible space. So that's a pretty big challenge. So have you found any solutions to help the user, the player, to help identify the space they're playing in?
Yeah, so the Skyrim version of Alexa, the Alexa version of Skyrim was made as a joke. So it's not a real game. Like no real game developers were involved in that, just so you guys know. I don't think it was meant to be a game. It was meant as a joke and kind of stayed. But yeah, I think if you try to build something where like knowing where you are, like and you got to look at the landmarks, like it's going to be difficult. Like in our game, we do away with this because, you know, it's a ship, but we just talk about the compartments, right? So we talk like, oh, let's go to the cryo, let's go to the engine room, let's go to the bridge. Those things work, and, you know, our brain deals with it fine. Like, you don't need to know if the bridge is, like, behind the engineering room or who cares. So you're just going to the place. So I think if you make, and there's a lot of games who are converted, like, you know, old school, like, text adventure games are converted into Alexa. And then you're doing things like north, north, west, and there's like people mapping them out, like, you know, where am I? Like, east, east, go back. I mean, it's not a natural use of that, and you know, the memory requirements, like they really need paper and all those things to make it work, etc. I think that's not what this is good for. I mean, you can probably make it work, but I think like you should probably try different things. The same way you don't want to do, you know, in a 2D space, you don't want to do certain things, and you gotta know your limitations. I guess that we're talking about.
And it's also environmental sounds. I mean, if it like the technical part of it advances, you'll be able to put much more audio design into games. Like we were able to make like a full audio design because it's a mobile game, and you can just like we have differences in input as well, but because you don't have to talk to it, you don't, no, it's a whole technical story. But if there are more possibilities for the smart speakers to do stuff like that as well, it's a really fun and easy way to have a feel for the room where you are. And that can be really easy as well. Just if you hear like the wind through the trees, that's already something that will heighten your sense of immersion.
Or, yeah.
And there's a lot of fun things to do there. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
Hey. You You mentioned earlier about, you talked about earlier about accessibility. I wanted to ask, what do you think about the possibilities to adapt pre-existing games? Because there are games like Fire Emblem who work on a board, or games like Pokemon who play in turn-based. And I there's people who talk about the possibility to adapt this for the blind.
I think that the most important thing in doing that is to make sure that you really know what the challenges are and what blind people need for that, because I think there's a lot of assumptions. Like, for instance, one of the things that I found really interesting in our game, which I would never have thought about, and we had, by the way, we had a UX designer who specialized in accessibility, so he did a lot of work in researching what we needed to do. But one of the things that we heard about was that because our game is exactly the same for blind and non-blind people, that was something that blind people really enjoyed, because they said, well, now I have the same experience as my friend who isn't blind. And that was something that I would never have thought about. So I think that there's, it's great to adapt games to make sure that they're accessible for more people. I mean, that's number one. That's very important, and I think that sometimes that can be done easier than you think. There's also a lot of discussion about, well, if you adapt stuff, then it might lose the original idea behind the game. I think that's something that every game designer has to decide for themselves. Like, how much am I giving up? Or am I actually giving up something? Or can I adjust this game to make it maybe even more interesting or better, and then make it accessible as well? So there's a lot of possibilities there, but I think the main thing is see what you have, see what the limitations are for the accessibility, and then decide if it makes sense or not. And hopefully it does make sense.
Hey, hello,
one more question.
Okay, so I had an idea for an audio game in 2008. And researching for audio games, I found like super hardcore audio games for blind people, like Blind Doom or Escape the Maze.
Yeah.
Like just with audio clues, but very, very faint, so blind people really know how to interpret them. And that got me thinking that, of course, my idea was just to do a novel or like a voice acted game. But have you guys experimented, or have you got any more ideas about doing something for other genres other than narrative games? Have you thought about it? Have you, I don't know, experienced some pitfalls or?
Yeah, I mean, definitely, like in our case, like the first game is a story. The next game we're working on also has a story element, but it also has like a multiplayer challenge aspect to it. The one thing that we really like is the conversational, like the fact that you use your voice for conversations. That's the thing that we really want to do. It doesn't necessarily have to mean a story. But yeah, I think stories are kind of good use of talking. I mean, that's one of the reasons why we talk, because we're always telling stories to each other. And so I think there's a natural thing there. But yeah, we want to try different things as well.
Is there any other question? One last question? No? Well, then I would ask you to give a warm applause to Julia and Jefferson for sharing
and Daniel.
Their knowledge here with us. Thank you all for coming.
Thanks, guys.